think, put a stool up there for me to sit on. I got it. Well, this is Palm Sunday, and as I shared with the children, it's also called the Sunday of the Passion. When I was in seminary, we first learned a new definition or a new understanding of what liturgy is. And when I was growing up, even as the son of a priest, and before I went to seminary, the priest in the mission that I was at was a very Anglo-Catholic, very high priest. Liturgy was what, you know, all that stuff that he did up there, the smells and bells and all that stuff. But in seminary, we were invited to hear that in a new way. And it was called a communal response to the sacred or the holy. Or in simpler words, as we worship, that worship is the work of the people. Work of the people as they gather and worship God and pray. And it used to be, and I don't know how many of y'all were involved in the Episcopal Church before 1979 with the Book of Common Prayer, but it used to be that the priest did everything. And you know, the priest did the host, he did the wine, he did the readings, did everything. And that has all changed as we all take part, as we all sing, we all share in the prayers, as we all gather around the altar with specific intent, and we all do the work of the people as we worship God. And if you stop and think about it, every week has a theme which we follow in. That's followed in the collect and the prayers and the music. And so each week there's a drama in which we take part. And there's no greater or expressive drama than the drama that we share in today. Today's liturgy to me is the most powerful and has the greatest contrast. It's the starkest liturgy of the whole year. And it's basically divided into what we think of as Palm Sunday and then the Sunday of the Passion. Because we start off and we're joyfully exultant, and you know, just like when Jesus triumphed entry into Jerusalem, and everybody was excited that here was the one who was coming in the name of God, and they all cried Hosanna, and Hosanna is not, it's not easily translated, but it means something like save me, save me. So that's what the people were saying as they rejoiced. They rejoiced with this one who was to come. Well, now the church tends to sometimes over-dramatize that. There, you know, in some congregations, they have Jesus come riding in the procession in a donkey. And sometimes that doesn't always go so well. David Wilk shared with us in Clarkus this past week. He's the director down at Holy Trinity. He said that one year they had someone dressed as Jesus who was leading a donkey, walk the donkey right down the aisle in the church, and the donkey got to the front door, the great doors of the, you know, Holy Trinity, these doors that open onto the expanse of grass and Flagler and those limbs, this grand procession. Well, the donkey got to the front door and balked. The donkey got there and stopped and would not go any farther. And of course, you know, the whole thing's going on, the hymn's going on, and finally, not trying to break the cover of the person playing the part of Jesus, David Wilton said, "Okay, Jesus, get that damn donkey back in the trailer." Well, the problem was his microphone was on, so the whole church heard it. The whole church heard it. My favorite story about Palm Sunday and that kind of approach to it is Bill Heathcock was my homiletics professor. Wonderful, wonderful guy. He was invited to preach one Palm Sunday at one of the big churches in Nashville, and they all had specific Palm Sunday vestments, and each of the priests had this beautiful scarf, this beautiful red scroll that said Hosanna down each side, and then palms on it. It was wonderful. And he got up in the pulpit to preach, and they filmed it. It was on television. He looked at it later, and he said, all you could see was ho, ho. Well, and that's kind of the feel of the first part of our liturgy. There is joy and exaltation. Then all of a sudden, it begins to spiral down. We read the Passion Gospel. We recognize and understand that second piece, that passion, is about the suffering of our Lord. It's not about love, lust, or interest. It's about our Lord's suffering. We read that and we take part. And thank you all for taking part in that. And that's part of what makes it a wonderful drama that we all take part in. That the voices come from all over the room. Powerful stuff. Powerful stuff. As we take part, as the work of the people. And the mood continues to spiral down. Listen to it and feel it. The music especially. Post-communion hymn today is one of my favorites. It just breaks my heart. It's a love song. My song is love on gold. My Savior God to me. It's a love song about a relationship with Jesus Christ who didn't do anything to anybody and yet was stripped and beaten and spat upon and put on the cross and died. And then finally, the last hymn, O Sacred Head Sword, just pours out that pain and that grief. So there's a huge contrast in the way this liturgy begins and the way it ends. Our focus changes. And we focus on our Lord's suffering. And do you know why? Anybody care to have a guess? Well, I'll tell you. It's because we can't go from Hosanna to Alleluia. We cannot go from the triumphal entry and that joy to the joy of the resurrection. We cannot approach the empty tomb and the glory of the resurrection without kneeling at the foot of the cross and seeing the pain and the agony on the Lord's face. Truth is, there are many more of you here than will be here through the course of the rest of this week as we mark those passages in our Lord's life. Our Lent program this year was entitled Embracing Spiritual Awakening. And one of the pieces that it talked about is that where the church is moving into the future, is moving from institution to experience. And it's a whole different way of looking at who we are as a community of faith. And one of the things that I think about that is that this week is one of the most, oh, it's not one of the most, it's the most powerful time of the community of faith to truly experience who we are and whose we are. Powerful, powerful stuff. As we become as Jesus' disciples, as we wash feet, as we take part in the Holy Meal, as we strip the altar and take our time, the altar of repose, and hear Jesus' voice say, can you not stay with me one hour? As we walk the way of the cross and do as Pilate did and wash our hands and carry the cross as Jesus did and rip the cloth as Jesus' garments were parted and drive the nails into that wood of the cross. And then Saturday as we share in the emptiness of our Lord not being in the world. The only day in the church year when must kneel and know that pain. So I invite you to come and share in the experience. To be the disciples of Jesus that we are called to do. To share in this part of his life. His pain. His death. Our grief. Then, as we do that, as we know the pain, as we know the grief, then we truly can rejoice on each other. First, we must come and kneel at the foot of the cross, gazing at that face of the cross. Amen.